Hey guys, welcome to another new, exciting, thrilling episode of Fright Fridays. And today we are talking about the 1999 movie Sleepy Hollow, starring the lovely Johnny Depp and the lovely Christina Ricci. So we're going to do a little dive onto this film today, one of my favorites for around this time of year, the spooky season. And so I hope you'll stick around. Thank you to everybody who has subscribed, liked, commented so far. You can find me over on Instagram at Night Owl Video as well, where I generally just post about what's coming up on the channel or that day's thing. So, but for today on Fright Friday, we're talking about this cool movie, 1999 Sleepy Hollow. This is a gothic supernatural horror directed by the one and only Tim Burton. And yes, I am a Tim Burton fan. So if you don't want to hear about Tim Burton, then you can check out right now, because I do generally enjoy his films. Probably not his more recent films, but the 80s and 90s stuff, oh boy, I'm all in. And this is no exception. Now, this is loosely based on the 1820 short story, The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, directed by Washington Irving, which I'm sure some of you probably read in school. I don't think I did read this one in school, but but I was definitely aware of it. And that reminds me of the Ichabod Crane cartoon from Walt Disney from the, I'm going to say the like 60s, 70s. I remember watching that on television on a Sunday. Sunday nights was always Walt Disney Presents. And around Halloween, they would always play the Ichabod Crane episode. I forget the official name of that episode, but I loved that episode and it actually really gave me the willies. So there could have been some nostalgia when I went to see this in the movie theater in 1999, because I was genuinely spooked by this film. The tagline for the film is "Heads Will Roll," and I remember seeing that when it came out, and I just thought, "Oh man, this is going to be exactly what I want." And it's going to be a Johnny Depp, Christina Ricci, Tim Burton directed version of Sleepy Hollow. It's, you know, hopefully it'll be gory and all this, but it's interesting, like putting this review together, because I was like, Tim Burton really hadn't done a horror movie per se till this point. And he even in my research, I discovered that he was like, I've never done a horror movie, so I have to kind of like rethink the way I do things and like consider some of my influences and things like that. So as I mentioned, this film stars Johnny Depp as Constable Ichabod Crane. It also stars Christina Ricci, Miranda Richardson, Jeffrey Jones, who you remember from Beetlejuice. He was the funny bigger guy there. I don't know, was he like a real estate guy or something? It's been a while since I saw that movie. I do like Jeffrey Jones. He was also the principal in Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And it also has a small part by one of my other lovelies, Christopher Walken, who plays a Hessian sort of like death machine, and he's just marching through what I guess is like New England in the 1800s, and he's just like slaughtering people, and he files his teeth down to points to make himself look more menacing. And like, wow, it was a great casting. Christopher Walken was so good in that role, even though it was a very tiny part of the movie. It's definitely like one of those scenes that like stuck with me big time. Yeah, so set in 1799, Sleepy Hollow is based on Washington Irving's classic tale, The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. Faithful to the dreamy, custom-bound world that Irving paints in his story, the film mixes horror, fantasy, and romance, and features an extraordinary cast of characters that dabble in the supernatural. So, yeah, that's the synopsis I copied off Google, but there's more to this story. This is really like, I've never read the short story. Shame on me for not doing that, but this has a lot more going on in it besides just like gore and this, the Headless Horseman. This is like a story about power. This is a story about family dynamics. This is a story about family, how different families interact within a small community, and like the ties that people have and the loyalties. And you know, it's got a lot going on in the film. It's not just, you know, your spooky Halloween film. There is actually like another layer underneath the blood and the horsemen that is like really about family dynamics and power, corruption, control within a small town and you or village, and you could kind of really imagine what it would have been like back in 1799, like how these little villages were so small and everybody knew each other, and everybody was kind of like, families were like interconnected through marriage and so it's cool. It plays into that stuff. So if you like that kind of stuff, if you like unraveling a mystery, then this is probably for you. So pre-production started as early as 1993 when Paramount Pictures wanted Kevin Yeager to originally direct it. And apparently his vision for the film was that it was going to be a low-budget kind of slasher-style film. I'm not sure how he had kind of envisioned that for this story, but that was his original idea. It was eventually given to Tim Burton in 1998 when Paramount Pictures decided they did not like Yeager's vision for the film, and so they decided to go with Tim Burton. Tim Burton, up to that point, had done The Batman, Batman Returns, Edward Scissorhands, Pee-wee's Big Adventure. So he was building a pretty nice little catalog, and he was showing like Hollywood producers that he had what it took to do like a really creepy atmospheric kind of film. I mean, Batman Returns is an incredibly atmospheric film, as well as Edward Scissorhands for that matter. So he was really developing his own kind of aesthetic. And again, I do love Tim Burton's style. So, I remember when this trailer came out, like, I was like, oh boy, I'm very excited. Like, I'm going to the cinema to see this one. So like I had mentioned earlier in this review, like, Tim Burton had really never done like a straight on horror film, or supernatural horror film. And so, apparently he kind of like went back in his kind of like history with film, and he decided to kind of pay homage to like Hammer horror films, and he also name dropped Black Sunday as a reference point for his inspiration for creating this film, and you know you can definitely feel that coming through, especially like the opening scene with the horse-drawn carriage, and there's like a big scary pumpkin in the field. I won't tell you what happens because I don't want to ruin it for you. But suffice to say, there's a lot of like very spooky lighting and imagery that creates this real tone. And then as the carriage is going down this long road into the village, this real spooky music comes on, like real low tone, kind of brooding kind of music. And every time I watch that movie, I like, even though it's within the first couple minutes of the movie, it's like one of my favorite parts of the movie, just that imagery and the music and the mood and the fog coming in, you know, through this supposed hollow. And it's, I love it. It's wonderful. So also to kind of like tie in with the old Hammer horror films, Tim Burton did get Christopher Lee to do a very tiny role at the beginning of this film as well, as like a magistrate, I think it was. He was kind of like he was the guy who sent Johnny Depp, Ichabod Crane, to Sleepy Hollow, because Ichabod Crane was kind of causing some waves in the New York City area, you know, with his, he had his own ways of like studying crimes and murder and that, like he devised his own instrumentation and stuff. And I think he was kind of getting on the nerves of like these magistrates and stuff. And so they sort of were like, basically like, either you go in the jail, you go in the cell for like so many days, or you can go to Sleepy Hollow and investigate these crimes of these beheadings. So he decides obviously to take the gig up in Sleepy Hollow. And so that's kind of how he gets to the village and that. But yeah, so Christopher Lee's at the beginning of the film, a little nod to Hammer Horror. For those of you out there who might be a little younger, Hammer Horror was a film production company that did a lot of mostly horror films. I think they did a few sci-fi films in the 60s, 70s, probably into the 80s, but they were mainly known for the 60s and 70s stuff. They did do like a resurgence in the mid 2000s with Woman in Black with the guy from Harry Potter in it. That was also a very good film. I should review that one actually. But the 60s and 70s stuff is untouchable, and it's so moody and beautiful and technicolor and creepy. And so you had Peter Cushing and you had Christopher Lee, and you had all of these guys were like the sort of mainstays of the Hammer horror. And so as an homage again, as a sort of a nod to Hammer horror, Tim Burton put Christopher Lee at the beginning of this. So cool little tidbit. This was filmed in a town called Tarrytown in New York. There were several houses, like period piece houses built around that, up in that area, around a pond or like a lake, I guess, at a cost of about 1 point something million dollars. And but you can really tell with the set design, it's really like cool look, very authentic looking. I mean, I'm not an expert on, 1800s New England architecture, but it looks pretty damn convincing to me. Other parts of the film were done at Levenston Soundstage in England, which did a lot of like, I don't know if Hammer filmed there or not. I'm not sure. I think they were at Elstree, but I probably it's a small, if you're imagining film production in the 60s and 70s in England, it's probably was some of it was done there. I'm guessing. Don't quote me on that, but and that the Levenston Soundstage had just finished wrapping up the filming of George Lucas's 1999 movie, The Phantom Menace, Star Wars Episode One. So that had just wrapped up. And I'm mentioning that for a reason because it comes back around here in a minute. So, special effects were done by Industrial Light and Magic, which is a George Lucas company, or was a George Lucas company. Now it's a Disney company. The majority of the special effects in the film were done practically. Like, oh yeah, I forgot to mention that before this, Tim Burton had done Mars Attacks, and in a lot of that, apparently there was a lot of computer-generated effects. So he wanted to kind of get away with that with this, and kind of do that kind of throwback thing again to like Hammer horror, and do more practical effects. Here's the Star Wars tie-in: Ray Park, who played Darth Maul in The Phantom Menace, was the stunt double for the as the Headless Horseman. So I thought that was kind of a cool tie-in. So I'm imagining probably he was there doing Phantom Menace. Pre-production started to roll in for Sleepy Hollow. He put his name in because he is a stunt. I believe he's a stunt man more than an actor. But he was Darth Maul in Phantom Menace, and he was also the Headless Horseman in this film. I think I read that he wore like a blue bag over his head so that they could ILM could like erase his head from the film to make it look like he was headless. The film score was obviously done by Danny Elfman. I mean, Tim Burton loves his Danny Elfman. And I just read, disappointingly, that this is getting a reboot that was announced this past summer, and it's done by a director that has done no film. They're doing what's that? They're doing another film that's coming out soon, and it's also a reboot. Like, all of the projects this person is attached to is a reboot are reboots. I'm just like, oh my God, Hollywood, please stop with the reboots. I mean, this was perfectly good. If you had the 70s Disney cartoon, and then you had this, and you've got the book, the Washington Irving short story, we got it covered. We don't need another reboot. Please stop making these damn reboots. But anyway, I've got very little faith in that, and I'll probably always stick with this one. I'm also a grouchy old curmudgeon, so I like my old movies. I like the old stories, but this one is definitely one of my favorites. And also something I didn't know about was that this was a when it came out, or just before it came out, they had a huge promotion online. I think it was like Sleepy Hollow dot com or something, sleepyhollowmovie.com, and it was like this huge thing because really movies hadn't really been promoted online before so much, and this was one of the first, I think, one of the first big budget movies to have like a really exhaustive website where people could go and do like live chats with the producers, and there was like apparently like videos, like interactive videos where you could like go through the set and like, you know, kind of like weave your way through the sets and things like that. So I don't remember ever visiting it, but I thought that was kind of an interesting fact that, you know, before that it was mostly just like TV campaigns and posters. And I mean, there was a book about the art of Sleepy Hollow and that kind of thing, but this was one of the early big experiments for Paramount online to promote their film and direct potential viewers to the website to find out more about the film, which probably was very exciting. I think I only got my first computer around that time, and I was really like not good at navigating the internet, so I probably didn't find this, but anyway, that was cool. The film had a budget of $70 million and it made $207 million at the box office, so a good return. It generally had very positive reviews. I think it has about a 70% on Rotten Tomatoes. Most of the critics praised Tim Burton's, you know, tone and his mood and the sets and things like that, and his ideas for that. But they did kind of criticize the pacing and the way that the story was kind of laid out. So there's a lot, like I said earlier, there's a lot of stuff going on in this film, and a lot of components in the story. And I have to agree with some of the critics, those components sometimes lined up very awkwardly and it was kind of hard to follow. I'm also a bit slow when it comes to like being able to follow all the, you know, like the names and all that. And like, but if it's well done, like say Lord of the Rings, for instance, there's a lot of characters that look the same and the names that sound the same, but it was so well done that I was able to follow the story straight through. This for me has some weird, you know, excursions into other parts where you kind of lose track of who's doing what. And so It for me anyway, it required several viewings, but maybe for you smart folk out there, you might just be able to, you know, take the ride and get right to the end and understand it and feel happy. But for me, it definitely took a few viewings. I did see this in the theater when it came out, and I loved it because I love the tone and the sets and the gore and the special effects and the acting and all that stuff. I'll get into that in a minute. So, this did win an Academy Award in the year 2000 for Best Art Direction, and it was nominated for two others, but it only won the one for Art Direction. So, clearly, you know, there's something going on. It won an Academy Award there. So, my thoughts on the film, I would definitely give this a 4 out of 5. Again, I like the atmosphere. I like the acting, I like the spooky music, I like the homage to Hammer Horror, because a lot of that Hammer Horror is the stuff I like to watch. But again, like I said, with a lot of the critics, they complained about the pacing and the kind of the layout of the story, and I would have to agree with them there. This edition is a 1999 DVD. It's 105 minutes, a little long, but not too bad. It's rated 14 in Canada. It is a Region 1 DVD. This is also a co-production. I think this is a co-production between the US and Germany, if I'm not mistaken. And I think that's at Mandalay Films. Special features on this DVD include commentary with Tim Burton, Sleepy Hollow Behind the Legend featurette, select cast biographies, exclusive cast and crew interviews, photo galleries, and two theatrical trailers. I did not watch any of the special features on this. I might go back and watch it just to see, because I don't think I've visited it. But it's a really good movie. I saw this in the movie theater. That's the Headless Horseman coming out of that real creepy tree, which was a set on the studio in England. I saw this in the theater by myself. It actually really scared me when I saw it, and I remember when it was about to come out on DVD, I invited one of my best friends over and my partner at the time, and I was like, you guys are going to freak. This movie's so scary. And then when we watched it, they were like, it wasn't scary. What are you talking about? But for me, I think it was just like being alone in the dark theater watching it and there weren't a lot of other people there, and it was just the setting and the, I don't know, it just really affected me, and I really, really enjoyed it. So I would definitely give this a 4 out of 5. No problem. You can watch it on, if you have a subscription to Paramount, you can watch it on there. You can also rent it on YouTube and Amazon Prime. And you can probably find this DVD relatively easy. I see it out and about quite a bit. This might even be in the $5 bin at Walmart for their Halloween season. So if you wanted to get it a physical copy, you could probably find it that way. But I see this on thrifting store shelves quite often. Not so much on VHS, but I definitely see the DVD fairly often. So if you want to get a copy of it, it's probably not going to be too hard to track down, or you can buy it online, I'm sure cheap. But yeah, I think it could be in like the cheapy bin at Walmart. But I would highly recommend this movie. If you like Tim Burton, especially the like 80s into like 90s Tim Burton, Johnny Depp's acting is great. He plays the kind of awkward, eccentric Ichabod Crane, which gives you that little comic relief there. He's kind of the fumbling guy, and he's got all the weird glasses and weird gadgets to inspect these murder scenes and stuff. So he's really charming in that role. Yeah, and just it's really good. It's real creepy. A lot of like the rooms in it where they're in rooms, it almost feels like claustrophobic, like they're like libraries filled with like books and papers, and it's very like all the characters are kind of like crammed in there, and it gives it this real creepy mood. So yeah, love this movie. Thumbs up from me at Night Owl Video. Sleepy Hollow, 1999, 105 minutes. Check this one out. Thank you so much for watching this review of Sleepy Hollow. I hope you enjoyed it. Well, we're coming into the week before Halloween, so it's kind of the spooky season. I didn't really plan anything special for the spooky season, but I borrowed my roommate's my friends' pumpkins. These are retro pumpkins from like the 70s, just to add some spookiness. But I don't know how effective that is. But so I'm thinking this coming Tuesday, I'm actually going to be talking about the 1983 supernatural horror film Christine, directed by John Carpenter, with a story based on a story written by Stephen King. I'm going to do that for Cult Movie Tuesday, even though, like, I don't know, I guess it is considered a cult classic now, but I haven't been really watching a lot of like cult movies, so I've been struggling to find content for the Tuesday, Cult Movie Tuesdays. So, but I am going to do Christine on Tuesday, and then I'm thinking maybe for Fright Friday next week, I'm going to do my like top 10 or top 15 horror films of all time. So I'm going to go through my collection, and I'm going to pick out my top 10 or top 15, maybe top 20, I don't know. And maybe next weekend, depending on my work schedule on that, I'm going to try to do some special programming for the weekend leading up to Halloween, which is on Monday. So stick around for that. And I don't know, I may come up with some other things between now and then, I don't know. I've been working a lot, as I mentioned in my previous video. I just got over being sick and my son's wedding, and so all that stuff. And so I'd like to do more, but right now it's a very busy time at work. So hopefully things will slow down in a bit and I'll be able to create more content. Before I go, I also wanted to give a shout out to my friend Judd Crandall. He just released episode 3 of his comic book Illegal Bodies. This is issue 3. I actually just got this the other day. I have not opened it yet. I have not unboxed it per se, but I did hear that this was like a gatefold kind of thing or something, or like a fold-out kind of thing. So let's just go ahead. I hope Judd isn't mad that I share that, but yeah. So it is kind of, it's a tri-fold. So you should definitely check this out. You can go to extrafinal.com, all one word, extrafinal.com. You can become a Patreon supporter of Judd's projects. This is really getting good. It's starting to kind of get some like in the last issue, there was some collage mixed in with the drawing, which I really, really liked. Actually kind of inspired me to maybe get doing some artwork again. This one appears to be a lot of collage actually, so and this will be continued in episode 4. So if you like indie comics, if you like folk horror, sci-fi, Illegal Bodies is your gonna be your jam. There are two episode issues out before this, but like I said, if you go to extrafinal.com, and if you're in St. John, New Brunswick, you can go to Heroes Beacon and you can pick it up. It's only $5. So shout out to my man Judd for doing this amazing comic book. You inspire me to be creative again because I have not been creative for some time. Anyway, that was my review of Sleepy Hollow, Tim Burton's classic. Go check it out. Leave comments below if you've seen this film, what you thought of it. I just simply adore this. This is definitely for me a every year at Halloween, I gotta watch this. I already watch it. I might even watch it next week just for the thrill of it, just because I love that movie so much. But let me know what your thoughts are on it. Give me the thumbs up if you like this content. Follow me on YouTube and Instagram at Night Owl Video. And until next time, I will see you out at the video store or out at the thrift store or out and about, or maybe, just maybe, we could meet up in Sleepy Hollow. Who knows? Take care of yourself until next time. Peace.